I was chatting with a friend of mine a couple weeks ago, and he asked, what's the topic this coming week? What type of person are we going to be talking about this weekend? And I said, well, I've kind of gone back and forth between a couple. And we'll probably do both of them at some point. I just hadn't decided yet. I said, we're either going to talk about arrogant people or angry people. And he's like, oh, dear. He said, I had a major mishap with my washing machine this week. Can we do arrogant and save angry for later? And I chuckled. I said, you know what? For you, let's do that. We'll skip angry until you cool off a little bit so it doesn't hit so close to home. And so I was going to do angry today, and then I came outside and I saw the snow, and I thought, well, I can't do angry now. The fickle weather has made me angry, so today we're going to talk about fickle people. We've been working through this series where we're looking at just some difficult personality types, characteristics that we run into all the time. And we can laugh about it, and we can just kind of enjoy the process of looking sometimes lightheartedly, maybe a little more introspectively at other times, at some of these qualities that we see around us, that we feel within us, and we can start asking the questions, why do people act this way, and what ought my response be when I see it in them, or perhaps what need I address in my own life in order to deal with some of these things about myself? So today we are going to talk about people who are fickle. Now, as I've processed this week, I've thought, what a funny little word this is, fickle. Yeah, it's kind of a cute word, right? Like it sounds pretty harmless, actually. But when we really look at what it means to be fickle, we quickly discover that fickle is a characteristic that has become an insidious tool of the enemy. We may not think much of fickle. We think of angry people and arrogant people, argumentative people, divisive people, and it's easy to think about the damage that's done when people act in those ways. But if we simply say, oh, you know, he's so fickle in his ways, or she's fickle quite often, I think, not a big deal. But as we look through the scriptures, I think we will find that the people who are fickle in their faith and in their behavior find themselves in time and in very dangerous territory. So this morning what I'd like to do is to look at a story, a lengthy story in Israel's history that shows a pattern when God's people exhibited this quality of being fickle. The book of Judges is actually an historic account of God's people walking closely with him and drifting away from him repeatedly. It's a cyclical story where we see God's people kind of settle into a routine where life seems to just find its comfortable norm. They experience success in life, peace politically, and over time they get comfortable, apathetic, lazy. And as they do so, they don't see as great a need for God. And they begin to drift away from him, and they fall into all kinds of sinful behaviors, and they find themselves drifting further and further away from God. And as they do so, they find themselves living way outside of the design that he had for them, his intentions for them, and life starts to fall apart. They begin to experience the consequences of their wicked and evil behavior, and life starts to go poorly for them. Eventually, it gets to be so bad that they find themselves unable to find their way through, and they begin to cry out to God again. They recognize that they have great need for someone to save them, and because they can't find it within themselves, they cry out to God. And he, because he's faithful, he comes near to them. They repent of their sin. They acknowledge their wicked ways. They come back and worship God again. And things turn around for them. He raises up leaders called judges to lead them against the nations that oppress them or attack them. They find themselves again in a season of peace and prosperity. And guess what happens? They get comfortable with it. And the process repeats. In fact, as you read through the book of Judges, you see this cycle repeat itself about 8 times. It looks like other relationships that we see fall apart over time. A marriage that slowly dissolves over years, where a couple once so passionate about each other drifts apart. They kind of fall away. They start doing their own thing, pursuing their own interests. Eventually recognizing that there's a great chasm between them in their relationship. Perhaps they seek counsel from someone who can help them come back together again. And they start to put some of those pieces together. And then as time goes on, they get comfortable, maybe relieved that they avoided a tragic end to their relationship. And quite often what happens is those bad habits creep back in, and this time it gets worse. There's some great betrayal that often happens between them. Perhaps there is forgiveness, and it reignites a passion for one another again. Great desire to be together, but as is normally the case, kids get older and have more things to do in and of themselves, and parents are distracted by careers and interests and all the rest of life that comes along. And they go through this cycle repeatedly until eventually there is very little left of their relationship. We see the same sad story with God and his people in the book of Judges. So the question then is, if we see a pattern and it repeats not only in the story of the Israelites in the book of Judges, but we can identify places in our own relationships where we see kind of this fickle nature of being close and devoted to others and then drifting apart and coming back again. We need to ask the question, how does fickle happen to us? How do we slide into that type of behavior? How did it happen with the Israelites, and what can be done about it? Well, God's people became fickle when, after many years of being enslaved in Egypt, God comes and he rescues them out. He leads them through the wilderness. He begins to fulfill the promises that he had given to Abraham and to them. He brings them to the land that he had promised them. After he's established significant relationship with them, he's created a system of law and order within their society and culture. He's acted miraculously on their behalf. He brings them to the land. They conquer most of the major cities in the land of Canaan. They divide the land up between the 12 tribes of Jacob. They begin to settle in and set up shop, build homes. Their leaders age and die. Joshua and Caleb pass on, and the people inquire of God what they ought to do next. And God commands them to cleanse the land fully of the people who had lived there when they arrived. Now, this seems harsh, and a lot of times we ask the question, why would God call them to shove and push out the people who already lived there completely from the land? There's a clue to that in Deuteronomy chapter 9. Before they enter the land, God says to them, after the Lord your God has driven them out before you, do not say to yourself, the Lord has brought me here to take possession of this land because of my righteousness. No, it's on account of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is going to drive them out before you. You see, the people who had settled into that area, they become incredibly wicked. And God was driving them out, preserving a sacred space where he might affect the entire world. We see the same kind of language in the day of Noah, when the Bible tells us that every inclination of man's heart was only wicked all the time. There come times in human history where we abandon God to such great length that he expels us from his presence. And so we see God bring his people into this space. He tells them, as they come into the land in Leviticus chapter 18, do not defile yourselves in any of these ways, because this is how the nations that I'm going to drive out before you became defiled. Even the land itself was defiled. So I punished it the land, for its sin, and the land vomited out its inhabitants. And if you defile the land, it will vomit you out, as it did the nations before you. You see, there is this standard that God has, where he calls his people to live in holiness. He calls us to righteousness. And so that as his people move into the land, God calls them to push out, to drive out those who are wicked living there already. And in Judges chapter 1 and 2, we see where this fickle nature settles in with God's people. God calls his people to drive them out completely, but they only partially obey. And in fact, in Judges chapter 1, we read, Manasseh did not drive out the people of Bethshan. When Israel became strong, they pressed the Canaanites into forced labor, but they never drove them out completely. And as you read over the next several verses, we see, nor did Ephraim, neither did Zebulun, nor did Asher, neither did Naphtali. And we see where God's people, in all of their areas, in all of the regions of the land, they refused or failed to obey God's commands. And so, as God is trying to drive wickedness away from his people, to create a space where they might worship him and draw close to him, they fail to obey completely. And now God's people, in their first generation, in relationship with himself, their spiritual roots are not that deep yet. Their experiences with God have been incredible, but limited. They have a short history with God, and because of this, they now find themselves, because of their disobedience to God, they find themselves surrounded by people who have very different philosophies in life. They find themselves surrounded by people that have different religious structures, different moral codes than themselves, different cultural traditions. They're living amongst people that have very different ideals than that which they have brought into this space. And those ideals began to influence them. The Bible tells us that as they interacted with their neighbors, that their neighbors' philosophies and moral codes and ideas began to influence how God's people believed, thought, and acted. In Judges chapter 2, we see the heart of the problem. Judges 2, starting with verse 16 says, then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of these raiders, yet they would not listen to their judges, but they prostituted themselves to other gods, and they worshiped them. They quickly turned from the ways of their ancestors, who had been obedient to the Lord's commands. Whenever the Lord raised a judge up for them, he was with the judge and saved them out of the hands of their enemies as long as the judge lived, for the Lord relented because of their groaning under those who oppressed and afflicted them. But when the judge died, the people returned to ways even more corrupt than those of their ancestors, following other gods and serving and worshiping them. They refuse to give up their evil practices and their stubborn ways. Let's look and see exactly what happens when we take a fickle approach, when our thoughts and our opinions change quickly with the season or with the crowd. We find certain problems begin to creep in. We see it here in Judges chapter 2. It starts off by saying, the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of these raiders. God sent help as his people recognized their own brokenness, as they recognized that life was difficult and they needed God's presence in it and his direction and guidance for it. When they cried out, God was faithful. He answered them, and it says that the Lord would raise up judges, leaders for them, not only to direct them, but it says that the judges saved them out of the hands of these raiders. But as we've said, these are a fickle people. And the very next statement is a sad one. It says, yet, or but, they would not listen to their judges. But they prostituted themselves to other gods and worshiped them. One of the things that we find in the story of the Israelites, time and time again, and other stories that we see as they play out in Scripture, and I think if you and I consider the friends that we have, or the coworkers that we have, who are fickle in nature, they kind of come and go, they're easily swayed, you will find that fickle people just aren't faithful. They're not faithful to their friends. They're not faithful to their family. The Bible tells us that they're not faithful to their God or to the leaders that he sends on their behalf. The Lord raised up judges. He gave them somebody to show them the way. God comes to their rescue. He pulls them out of the hands of those who are oppressing them and attacking them. And the very next statement is, yet they would not listen. If we back up just a little bit in that same chapter, God says to his people through the angel of the Lord, it says the angel of the Lord in chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim. And he said, I brought you up out of Egypt, and I led you to the land I swore to give your ancestors. Talking about Moses, Jacob, Isaac, Abraham before all of them. The Bible tells us that the angel of the Lord had appeared to all of them as well. Had offered promises, had entered into a binding covenant relationship with them. And God says, I brought you up out of Egypt. I led you to the land I swore I would give to your ancestors. I said, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall not make a covenant with the people of this land. See, covenant is an interesting arrangement that we see in all of human history, not just biblical history, but secular history as well, where two different people groups would make an arrangement, a covenant agreement with one another to share resources, to protect one another's political interests, to fight in one another's battles against now common enemies. You see the two people groups, the two nations, the two tribes, the two individuals, once they enter covenant, function as one person or one group of people. And God says, when I made covenant with you, I offered you certain promises. And I will not fail to keep my side of that covenant. And he says, but because of my great agreement, my arrangement with you, you must not also make covenant with these wicked people who will not follow me, who refuse to obey me. You cannot live in perfect harmony with me and with them, because we stand for very different things. Don't enter covenant with them, God says. You shall not make a covenant with the people of this land, but you shall break down their altars. Yet you've disobeyed me. Why have you done this? God is saying to this group of people, these are the individuals who saw God in Egypt act miraculously on their behalf, showing his power and his authority, his sovereignty over all of the gods of Egypt. This is the God who led them to and across the Red Sea as he parted it before them, and then brought the sea back together over the pursuing army of Egypt. This is the God who fed them and gave them water in the wilderness, who met them at Mount Sinai, gave them his law, who healed them of their diseases, who made their shoes and their clothes last for 40 years without wearing out, who had crossed the Jordan River, conquered the fortified city of Jericho and Ai and all of the others. He had shown himself faithful to them time and time and time again, even when they tripped up and they were disobedient in the wilderness, when they worshiped and crafted other false gods for themselves. God still forgave, and he still walked with and protected them. He fulfilled his promises to them. And as soon as they come into the land, they are surrounded by other people, and they begin to adopt their gods, their false religion. After all God had done, they worshiped someone else. There was no loyalty from them. You see, as soon as they found themselves in the land, as soon as God had, quote-unquote, finished fulfilling his side of the deal with them and had fulfilled his promises to them, as soon as they felt secure in the land, they walked away from him. They were comfortable. They had enough. And they deserted him. You see, some people are just fickle that way. And unfortunately, with those who are fickle in their relationships, their dedication to you is directly proportionate to their dependency on you. Let me say that again. Their dedication, their loyalty to you is directly proportionate to their dependency on you. And as soon as they don't need you, they quite often will abandon you. Do we find this true of ourselves? Do we seek God's face when we need nothing from his hand? Do we still pursue him? Do we spend time in his word? Do we spend time in conversation with him when life is going well? When we have all that we need? Or is our dedication to him also proportionate to our dependency on him? Do we recognize that we need him in all seasons? The good news is God is faithful. He is loyal. He keeps his promises, even when we do not. Fickle people are often unfaithful people. As we read in Judges chapter 2, though, not only do they quickly abandon God and those that God sends to help them, but verse 17 goes on to say they quickly turned from the ways of their ancestors who had been obedient to the Lord's commands. Not only do they abandon God, but they abandon those lifestyles, they abandon those commands and the ways of living that God had instructed them to follow. You see, fickle people are also not very consistent in their convictions quite often. Not only are they unfaithful to friends and family, but they're inconsistent with their convictions. A number of years ago, I served on a board for an organization, and we had some pretty significant decisions to make about the direction of the future of this organization. And there were fairly strong feelings about the right path to take, and not all of those feelings were shared, were the same. There were different opinions about what we ought to do, and I had a good friend that also served on that board with me, and we would often discuss the topic outside of those meetings, just trying to wrap our head around all of the different pieces of it. And as we talked over really weeks and months and conversations together, we realized that we shared the same thoughts and values. We came to the same conclusions, and we could recognize by the meetings that we were attending with the rest of the board that we were probably in the minority. Our opinions weren't shared by most people on the board, but my friend was pretty influential with this particular group of people. And so I had hope that we would be able to sway things in a direction that we thought was most appropriate and healthy. Came time for this board to make kind of a final decision on the matter. And we came to the board meeting, and people shared opinions about what they thought we should do. And eventually I kind of spoke up and offered maybe a different perspective, hoping to help them see that perhaps there was another path that we could take, and in my opinion was a better one. And I did so waiting for my friend to kind of chime in and to speak also toward those ends. And as I finished, he spoke up, and I thought, okay, if he can just help them kind of recognize just the significance of this decision. And he spoke up, and over the next 10 minutes, he spoke directly against everything that he and I had discussed in private. You see, his convictions and his opinions had changed with the room. When it was just he and I, he shared the most popular opinion, mine. When we were in a larger room with people who thought very differently, he still shared the most popular opinion. I was so discouraged. Now, over years, I recognized this wasn't a moral issue, and things worked out fine. But I always thought it was just fascinating how quickly his opinion changed in that moment, and how deeply it affected me, how wounded and betrayed I felt for a good bit of time after that. Sometimes people's convictions that you think are deeply held turn a corner very quickly. They change with the popularity in the room. They change based on personal advantage sometimes, what is most financially advantageous. Sometimes they change because there's just an easier or more comfortable path, even if it's not the most appropriate or right path. You see, convictions change with fickle people. And as you read through the story of God's people in the book of Judges, we see this repeated conviction. The Israelites again did evil in the eyes of the Lord. This phrase gets repeated numerous times in the book of Judges. And again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Judges 2, 11, 3, 7, 3, 12, 4, 1, 6, 1, 10, 6, and 13, 1. And again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. You see, when they needed God, they held to his standards. They acquiesced to his regulations. It appeared that they had embraced them for themselves, that they saw the value of living with these parameters in their relationships with one another and with God. But as soon as they began to walk away from their need or felt that they had no need for God, then they also drifted from those convictions which weren't their own. They were God's convictions, but they never internalized them for themselves. With those who are fickle, goodness is subjective. With those who are fickle, that which is right is subject to change. There's a problem with that. Because if our morality is mobile, if what we hold to be good and right and true is not immutable, if it changes and moves from one place to another, then the space that it vacates becomes a haven for corruption and oppression and mistreatment of others. When we are willing to abandon our morality because it's difficult or unpopular, the right treatment of others who are weak, who are outsiders, who are less desirable than others, isn't guaranteed. We see that in our own culture. Fairness, equal opportunities, dissolves when what is right moves. When those foundational principles of how we ought to behave are not standard, when they're subject to popular opinion, and they move from one place to another, then people swoop in because they find a space where they now have opportunity to behave as they desire, to do as they wish, to pursue that which is best for themselves, because there's no standard to hold them accountable at that point. Mobile morality is incredibly dangerous, and fickle people are inconsistent with their convictions. There's one final thought that we learn from those who are fickle as we read the story of Judges, as we examine what happened with God's people. It doesn't affect them as much as it affects those who come after. Because fickle people fail to leave a legacy for their children. I'm not talking about a legacy of greatness, a reputation to be boasted about, stories to share about how amazing this generation has been. What I'm talking about is a standard, a set of deep substantive culture or heritage, this collection of experiences and wisdom that builds from one generation to another. We're seeing some really incredible advancements in our world today, technologically, scientifically. Some amazing feats of human ingenuity are happening constantly around us, but you know, Elon Musk doesn't reach for Mars on his own. He and his teams stand on the knowledge, the wisdom, and the experiences of generations that have gone before. And God recognizes the importance of that built understanding and wisdom over time. In fact, before his people entered the land, he said to them, "These are the commands and the decrees and the laws that the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you're crossing the Jordan to possess." These are Moses' last words. The book of Deuteronomy is kind of a long sermon from the mouth of Moses. And he says, these are the decrees and the commands and the laws that your law, the Lord your God has directed me to teach you. He goes on to say, these commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. And then he says, impress them upon your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Moses says, these decrees and commandments from God, impress them upon your kids. Talk about them everywhere, at home and throughout your day as you go. Look for opportunities to use those teachable moments to begin to press them into the character of your kids. This was one of the most fundamental instructions that God had given his people as they entered the land. But as we get to the book of Judges, not 40 years later, Judges 2, verses 10 and 11 says, after that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors or had died, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. And for the first time we read this phrase, then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and they served the Baals. See, God had commanded his people, you have a responsibility to acknowledge what I've done on your behalf, to tell those who have not witnessed it firsthand, to impress upon them the goodness of your God, upon your children, to teach them the standards by which he's called us to live. Impress on them, or the next generation will grow up and know neither the Lord nor what he's done for us. Church, it is a scary reality that we are always just one generation away from a completely godless society. One generation. If we don't leave a legacy of what we have come, not only to know about God, but to leave a legacy of what we have experienced from him and with him in our own lives, it will be foreign to our children. It will be unrecognizable to them. And the reality that we read in Judges 2:19, when the judge dies, when one generation is gathered to their ancestors, the people return to their ways even more corrupt than those of their ancestors. We cannot leave our children lost without a heritage of who God is and what he has done and what he desires to continue to do and fulfill within their lives. If we are fickle in our faithfulness, if we are not committed to living by convictions that we have internalized and embraced for ourselves because the God of the universe has given them to us for our own benefit, then we will find that our children will neither know him nor what he has done. And they will suffer greatly by being absent from him. We cannot be fickle. We must be stalwart in our faith, absolutely faithful to the one who has been nothing but faithful to us. We must be committed to the convictions that he has given us, that he impresses on us through the work of his Holy Spirit, and live and speak in a way that helps them understand who he is and how he pursues them as well. God, we come to you this morning recognizing that being fickle is just not an option. Lord, that coming and going as it suits us, or pursuing you and abandoning you when we We fail to recognize our great need for you causes damage not only to ourselves, but to those around us and ultimately to those who will come after us. Lord, you are always faithful. You do not waver between your love and your wrath for us. But God, you stand ready to forgive and to receive. You fulfill all of your promises out of your great love. Lord, your word shows us that you are absolutely holy and righteous in all that you do. You instruct us and enable us to be the same in our own lives. And God, you call us to speak. To speak of what we have experienced in you. The great benefit that we have in our relationship with you. That others might see it and be affected by it as well. That they might come to know you intimately themselves. Lord, may we be more like you and not be fickle in any of our ways. Amen.
Shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise. To Christ our King. The fear that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. From the ashes of defeat, the resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. Victory, the resurrected King is resurrected. soldiers watched in vain was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat.
That is broken.
hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Streets of gold, I'll see how you save my soul.
star in the solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you healed my heart, you changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God.